Good morning. So I was telling the first service this. As a guest preacher, before you come out on the stage, you're a little, let's just say energetic, okay? And then, you know, what happens is usually you sit on the side over here and then you start the process of just kind of mellowing out. But then our worship team comes out here and does that, okay? So now I'm all fired up again. So if you get too much energy this morning, you got to blame Pastor Zach. It's all his fault. So as Pastor Scott said, my name is Jesse Edwards, and it's just a privilege to be with you here again this summer as one of the guest preachers. And whether you're here in person or online, we're just excited to have you join us today to explore God's Word. Now, I've been attending Crossroads since 2011 when my wife, Erin, and I had just a blessing to be invited to Crossroads by Mark and Mary Graves. And some of you may know the Graves. I mean, they were so excited and fired up about what was going on at Crossroads that they invited us to a church in a movie theater. And we came, all right? I mean, my wife and I, we sat down in a seat, and we took in a beautiful service from Pastor Jeff. And then 3 hours later, someone sat in that same seat and, like, watched a movie, like the remake of Footloose, okay? And I looked it up, 2011, remake of Footloose came out. Not the Kevin Bacon version, the remake. And it actually made $50 million, believe it or not. So I don't know what's more remarkable, how well that movie did, or that they keep allowing me to come back and be with you guys up here on this stage. And after sharing that story, I think this might be my last time. So anyhow, excited to be here, guys. Obviously, it's a toss-up, but just truly a blessing to be here exploring God's Word with each of you. Now, if you've been following with us the last few months, we're in a series where we are examining some of the more remarkable interactions where Jesus is teaching. And as we know, he commonly does so with parables. I mean, these are these really cool stories where Jesus, he would chronicle these profound truths. He would share wisdom. One scholar called parables earthly stories with a heavenly meaning. And this was a very common method of teaching because they were easily remembered. I mean, the listeners, they could easily retain and recall parables because of the bold symbolism and the unique characters in the story. Now, I got to tell you, as someone who was raised in the South, my father, in fact, is from the Bayou of Mississippi. Let's just say bold symbolism. Unique characters, these are normal means of discussion where I'm from. And I'll tell you what I mean. My father would say, that guy attacked the Golden Corral buffet like a chicken on a June bug. True story. And I'll translate for you guys up north here. What he was saying is that gentleman demonstrated urgency to fill his plate, okay? Or I'll give you another one. My dad would say, this macaroni and cheese is something else. Your mama definitely put her foot in it. You heard that right. Your mama definitely put her foot in it. I'll translate again for you guys. This macaroni and cheese is really tasty, all right? I could do this all day long. I'll just give one more for the sake of time. My dad would say, man, Lewis, there's going to be some sweat in the city. That's what he calls me, Lewis. Sweat in the city. Translation? Uh-oh. This is kind of concerning, all right? So when it comes to unpacking meanings behind very illustrative communication, I guess what I'm trying to tell you guys is I'm your guy. I'm your guy, okay? All jokes aside, we have two really powerful parables, and we're going to explore it today together. And we're going to begin by spending time in the book of Matthew, and my prayer is that during our time this morning, we grow closer to our Heavenly Father as we dive into His Word and, more importantly, uncover its truth. But before we do that, I would just invite you to bow your heads so we pray before we kick this off. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for just being in your house of worship and exploring and uncovering the truth in your word. And we'd ask, Heavenly Father, that you excavate hearts and minds here this morning so that there is room for your Holy Spirit, that would just work in this room. And as your preacher here this morning, I would ask that you just protect me from me. You don't need my permission, but use me as you see fit so that there might be some type of connection between the soul and the cross. In your good and glorious name we pray. Amen. Amen. All right. So, again, our two parables that we're going to focus on this morning, they take place in the book of Matthew, and they're great examples of how Jesus would show us how to prepare for life in his eternal kingdom. The context here, Jesus, he had spent the last few days teaching, and afterwards, he's just hanging out with his disciples, and his disciples are like, Jesus, why do you teach this way? Why do you share parables when you teach? And he explains this in chapter 12, why he used these very familiar objects, scenarios, relationships, and compared those to situations that required further explanation. How he challenged the audience to discover the truth in his words, while also concealing that same truth from those completely unwilling to hear and see the wisdom in what he was sharing. So he explains this to the disciples. He actually shares a few more other parables in doing so, and it perfectly sets the table for the two that we're going to discuss today. And that's the parable of the hidden treasure and the parable of the pearl merchant, otherwise known as the kingdom parables. So please turn to Matthew 13, verse 44. And whether you have your Bibles, whether you have your outlines, you're following along in the Crossroads app, you have none of that, you'll still have it on the screens to my left and to my right. So if you got it, Matthew 13, verse 44, and you're ready to explore God's word with me, please give me an amen. All right, now look, I want to make sure that you really have it and we're ready to explore God's word. So if you have it, give me an amen.
Amen.
Beautiful. Now we're ready to go. And we're actually going to start in verse 44. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field. When a man found it, he hid it again. And then in his joy, he sold all he had and he bought that field. So what's going on here? Well, remember, in the land just frequently ravaged as Palestine, many people had to bury their treasures. Remember, there's no, like, reliable, secure entity where you could take your valuables. There's no U.S. bank. There's no Wells Fargo. So, you know, you got to do something else here. And what folks did is, for safekeeping, they buried their valuables in their field. So to find a treasure in a field would not only be rare, but to find a very valuable treasure would be very, very rare. However, in this parable, a man finds this treasure, and it was just so precious. I mean, it was so amazing, so promising, so glorious, that he's willing to immediately and joyfully purchase the field to ensure his possession of it. And you see, by purchasing the field, he absolutely ensures that he can have it. It removes all possibility of dispute. I mean, the treasure, it would absolutely be his, and he desperately wanted it. Now, these two parables, they do have similarities. Verses 45 and 46 have to do with a slightly different emphasis. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant looking for fine pearls. When he found one of great value, he went away and sold everything he had and he bought it. So in the second parable, we're dealing with a merchant whose profession is to seek fine pearls. So this is a guy who knows what he's looking for. And when he discovers a pearl of significant, substantial value, he pumps the brake and takes action. I mean, he's seen a few over the years, and this particular discovery surpasses anything he had seen before. So much so that he actually considers it a rational action to exchange everything he owns for it. Everything. And as Pastor JR has reminded us, we don't really need a Greek word for everything, folks. It just means everything. All of it. So the ultimate connection between these two parables has to do with the supreme worth of the kingdom of God. Whether we discover it in verse 44, or we're looking for it in verses 45 and 46. And while Jesus, he doesn't actually explain these two parables in depth like he did the previous four, before we go any further, it is important that we take a couple steps back, and just make sure we're on the same page. So the first, we have to be careful in how we assess what Jesus is saying here. Now, there's various interpretations of parables. And as Pastor Adam reminded us a few weeks ago, we have to be careful when we study these because folks get really creative, in assigning different meanings to a variety of details. And that can get us in trouble because the point of Jesus' parables, I mean, they're usually pretty straightforward versus like some, you know, complex secret meaning. We got to be cautious. Let's not overthink it. Let's not take liberties with the message. To understand the parables, we just have to realize what was the message that Jesus intended for his audience at that time, and why is he sharing this short story in the first place? The second thing, we also know from Jesus' previous teachings that these parables, they are not about transactions. And the Bible clearly teaches us you cannot purchase your way into heaven or the kingdom of God. Okay? I mean, you can't do it with money, you can't do it with possessions, you can't do it with good works, and you can't do it with being a good person. It's actually the opposite of Jesus' teachings. It's the opposite, which focuses on a relationship with Christ as the only route to the kingdom of God. And that sin, it separates us from God. And only way we can repair that separation is by fully embracing the death and resurrection of his son, Jesus. Amen. Because then and only then can we attain the eternal salvation in the kingdom of God. So we're on the same page, not a transaction-based focus here. Instead, these two parables have to do with the supreme worth of the kingdom of God. I mean, Jesus, he's referring to something so incredible here, so incredible, that you'd absolutely want it in your life, so much so that it'd be worth giving up all you have to get it. But let's examine that. Why? Why is it worth giving up all you have to get it? I mean, why would you want the kingdom of God? I mean, you have to ask yourself, is it worth it? It's not a trick question. It's worth it. It's worth it. Because a relationship with Jesus, it impacts your eternity. It impacts your eternity, and it impacts if you're going to spend it in heaven. I mean, let's talk about heaven. I mean, we're talking about a place where there's no sin and there's no suffering. There's no evil, there's no pain, there's no dictators, there's no war. We're talking about no sickness, no addiction, no depression, no anxiety, no abortion, no starvation, no malnutrition, no poverty, no homelessness. A place with no divorce, no split families, no neglect, no abuse, no human trafficking. I mean, does that sound like a place where you'd like to spend some time? Okay. I mean, well, how about eternity? I mean, how about eternity? I mean, in a world that is so broken, so disjointed, it's sometimes hard for us to wrap our minds around what heaven truly is, this beautiful paradise, where we get to spend it with eternity with our King. I mean, that right there is the main point of what Jesus is teaching in these parables. And that's really where we're going to focus our time this morning. Because the bottom line is what you give up cannot compare to what you'll get. I mean, what Jesus is teaching in here is once you recognize truly what the kingdom of God is, you do anything to get it. Because nothing else on earth can compare to life with Jesus. But do we really believe that? I mean, that's what these parables are about. So for the rest of our time today, we're going to look at three questions to help us determine if that's true for you and if it's reflected in your life. So it's going to bring us to our first of those three ways to vet this out and the first bullet point in our outline. And that's, what do you truly value? What do you truly value? In these parables, what would compel someone to take such significant and dramatic action? Well, if you know what you're getting is more valuable, then most of us would give up anything or everything to get it. And I'll tell you what I mean here. Some of you watch TV, and you may have seen a show over the years called Storage Wars. Anybody here seen the show Storage Wars? Yeah. Okay, a lot of hands here. That's a good thing. It's been on A&E for like over a decade. It's a fascinating show. I mean, it's like so America, where we have like so much stuff that we actually rent storage units to put our extra stuff, okay? Well, some of these storage units, you know, for whatever reason, they get abandoned, and the storage unit company essentially repossesses all of the contents inside of them. So the show is based on folks who try to buy the contents of those abandoned units. They get a quick peek of what's inside, they try to assess the value, and then in an auction-style process, they have to outbid others for the opportunity to own everything in the abandoned storage unit. With the hope. that they're getting something much more valuable inside than what they paid for it. Well, one of the most lucrative hauls in the history of this profession, if you want to call it that, is when a storage unit was purchased and inside the unit they found a safe, and inside that safe they found $7.5 million. 7.5 large, okay? So the question is, let's say you're on Storage Wars, okay? And you know there's a safe in there with $7.5 million. How much would you bid to get that storage unit? I mean, a lot, right? 100,000? 200,000? 300,000? $300,000 for $7.5 million? My 7-year-old daughter could do that equation. She would do that. She would take that deal. The problem is, most of us, myself included, we don't just have like $300,000 laying around, okay? So now, what would you do to raise the $300,000? Would you sell all that you had? I know the Edwards family would. Okay. I'm going to tell y'all what. You've seen some yard sale signs over the year. You've seen nothing like the aggressive yard sale campaign the Edwards family would put forth in order to get you to our home to help us raise the money. Okay. You know those places where the companies are like, they're going out of business, so they say everything must go? It would be everything must go. I mean everything. The house, the cars, the clothes, the cat. Everything's going. Everything's going. I mean, and if my daughter's listening, I'm kidding, honey. We wouldn't get rid of your cat, right? But we would. If we had to raise cash for this situation, Miguel gots to go, okay? That's the name of our cat, Miguel. Anyways, Amir, if you're listening, it's just hypothetical, honey. It's hypothetical. Okay. But the point is in both these parables, the finder receives something of much greater value than their worldly possessions. And don't miss this. The same is true for us. We're getting a lot more than what we're giving up. We're talking here about an eternal and everlasting relationship with our Heavenly Father versus a gaggle of world possessions. And I'll even take this one step further. There's excitement to do this. I mean, let's take a look again at verse 44 up here on the screens. And I'm going to read it. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field. When a man found it, he hid it again. And then in his joy, went and sold all he had and bought that field. I think one of the details that could be missed here is in his joy, went and sold all he had. I mean, this man didn't do it begrudgingly. He didn't have to be pushed, pulled, or prodded. He did this blissfully, happily, and gladly. I mean, a lot of folks do a lot of amazing things in a lot of places, including here at Crossroads. But is it always joyful? I mean, I know I'd have to answer that question if I was being honest. I mean, would we joyfully abandon everything to secure our relationship with Christ? I guess the better question is, what does that man in the first parable know that we don't know? He sees the value in knowing Jesus, being a part of God's kingdom, and he values it so much that he joyfully gives away everything to get it. So, you know, the question is, what do you value? Actually, the better question is, what do you tend to value more than knowing Jesus or living for his kingdom? I mean, maybe it's that relationship that you really want, even though you know it's wrong. Well, there's places where you are hanging out, but you know you shouldn't be there. Maybe it's that show on Netflix that you love to watch, but you know you shouldn't. Or that music you'd like to listen to, but you know you shouldn't. Or the stuff on, you know, social media or the internet that you know you should not click into it, but you click into it anyways. What Jesus is teaching us right here is that nothing the world can offer can compare to what we'll gain through living for him and for his kingdom. I mean, compared to knowing Jesus, none of the stuff I just described are more valuable, because at the end of the day, it's temporary. It's short term. And compared to Jesus, they simply cannot compare. So that's going to bring us to our second question to help determine if the kingdom of God is worth it to you. And that's, where do you ultimately place your confidence? Where do you ultimately place your confidence? So he joyfully gives it up, and the merchant sells everything because they know what they're getting. They're confident that nothing they give up will ever even come close to what they're getting. So I want to tell you a story about confidence. It's actually a story about completely irrational confidence. And as my wife would tell you, this is something I've suffered from a long time. Completely irrational confidence. My wife actually comes from a small town in Wisconsin called Spencer. And we were there a few months ago for their annual town picnic. Now, some of you from Wisconsin, you know what these annual town picnics look like. They're awesome, right? There's like food trucks, it's a carnival atmosphere, maybe there's like a bags tournament, fireworks, parade. And we go back because not only to visit my in-laws, but my wife was in the parade. She's in the parade every year. because she won Miss Spencerama, which is kind of like the fair of the fair, fairest of the fair. So that's right, my wife won Miss Spencerama. And I guess what I'm trying to tell you guys is that I married Miss Spencerama, okay? That's what I'm trying to get at here. Anyways, my wife is here, hates that I'm sharing that story, but I appreciate you letting me share it, honey. Anyhow, so part of the festivities this year, they had a baby back rib cook-off, okay? First, second, and third place for who could make the best baby back ribs, all right? So guys, I like to smoke meat. Actually, I love to smoke meat. In fact, I'm smoking two briskets as we speak right now for my family to consume when I get home today. All of you guys are invited. All of you guys are invited, okay? I like to smoke meat so much that I could build a sermon around the five smokers that I own in the potential idol issue that we're dealing with here, okay? Maybe that's something we unpack in 2023 if they let me come back. So anyhow, my wife says, you know, Jesse, you should do this. And I'm like, yeah, I should. I mean, it's fun. Plus, I'll probably win, you know. So yeah, let's do it. Let's do it. But there's some problems here, guys. One, I've never cooked baby back ribs in my entire life, not once. Two, I don't even eat pork. Maybe like an occasional brat every few years, but I just don't eat pork. Again, another subject for another sermon. And three, I have no reliable method 3 hours from my home to actually smoke these ribs. Pellet smokers, these are big smokes. These are big things. They're not easily transported. No easy task, especially when you have like four kids in the car going with you to make the trip. Despite that, I was absolutely convinced that I had this, So I come together with this recipe, a strategy, and I figured out I could use my father-in-law's like old school barrel, like charcoal smoker, which I'm very grateful for. But as he helps me on the day of the contest, we get there, and let's just say it was a bloodbath, all right? Some might even say there was some sweat in the city. I knew I was in trouble when I was like surrounded by these guys with beards, which somehow made it seem like they knew how to smoke, okay? They had like a sea of like super expensive like pellet and propane grills, these massive grills. And I'm talking to these folks. They had done multiple dry runs the weeks before. They have their family like try out these ribs and give them feedback. A couple of guys, true story, made ribs to eat throughout the day while they simultaneously made ribs to put into the contest. And then there's me. I don't know if you saw that picture. There's this guy who's sitting there with the old barrel charcoal smoker that was in the back of my father-in-law's shed for like the last two decades. And I mean, the folks I'm competing with, it's like a couple of Guy Fieri's, Bobby Flay's. And then there's me. I mean, I had like entered the Tour de France, except for I didn't know how to bike and I had a mountain bike. I mean, I was way out ahead of my skis. And so a lot of competitors, first, second, third place, all these other fringe awards, a lot of names called that day. Jesse Edwards was not one of them. And I could tell things are bad when like the other competitors are coming up to me. It's like, oh man, so cool. You brought your little smoker from Sheboygan and that's been neat. So nice to have you here. And it was, they pitied me. But you know what? I'm unfazed. I'll be back in 2023 and I'm going to win with that same smoker, okay? Same smoker, all right? I need you guys as judges to come with me to Spencer. But you know, what I just described to you guys is what we call irrational confidence gone wrong, okay? That was irrational confidence gone wrong. But what the man and the merchant show us in these parables is rational confidence gone right. It's rational. It's well-placed. The complete opposite of my situation. And that's because the man and the merchant, they see value. They know what they're getting. It's foundational so they can have true confidence. But the question is, where do you truly place your confidence? I mean, if you honestly reflect on your life, is it obvious where you place your confidence? And does it weigh more towards things of the world versus a focus on God? Because if we have confidence in Christ's promise, I mean, it's evident. Because when we're confronted with that truth, with that promise, we eagerly take steps. We take actions to seek out God. Because really, I mean, at the end of the day, we can rest in who God says we are. I mean, we approach suffering differently because, you know what? It's temporary. I mean, we approach relationships differently. I mean, we don't have to run ourselves ragged chasing the American dream. We don't have to do it. The money, the stuff, the appearance, the status. Because we're confident in who we are in Jesus. And more importantly, where we'll spend it forever. And that's going to bring us to our third way to help determine if the kingdom of God is worth it to you. What are you willing to sacrifice for a much greater reward? What are you willing to sacrifice for a much greater reward? Now, as we discussed earlier, you can't buy your way into heaven with actions, okay? But you must be willing to pay the cost. I mean, think about the folks in these parables. I mean, they're not subtle. They weren't gentle. They didn't do a little. They were all in. Because if you truly value the kingdom and have confidence in it, you are willing to sacrifice everything to obtain it. I mean, let's take a step back. Why did Jesus share these parables in the first place with his disciples? He doesn't want them to miss out. He does not want them to miss out. He wants them to know they're in the kingdom based on their response, behaviors, and actions. I mean, let's look at these verses again. And I want you to pay attention to the words that are underlined. And I'm not going to read them. But what Jesus is talking about is the man and the merchant, they're doing stuff. When they got the promise, they did stuff. In both parables, they had to burn some calories, okay? I mean, these are verses filled with action verbs. Found, hid, went, sold, bought, looking. It was worth all they had, and they had no problem taking all measures to acquire it. But what about us? I mean, are we willing truly to give up other things in our life that compete for our attention and affection? I mean, what about our hopes, our dreams, our visions for what we thought our life was going to look like? I mean, what about our plans for our spouses, our families, our careers? What about this one? What about that sin in our life that we kind of like? I mean, I'll be honest with you guys, like teaching from Jesus like this sometimes makes us uncomfortable. Makes me uncomfortable. I mean, would God really ask me to give up something that I love? Yeah. The answer, according to this parable, is yes. But that's okay, because compared to an eternity with him in a place of perfection, nothing you could give up could compare to what you'll gain. I mean, many of us, we want to have that relationship with Christ. We want to be saved from our sin. But it gets a lot harder when we start talking about the stuff we have to give up, adjust, or change. I mean, we want to be with Jesus, but we also kind of want to live the way we've been living. He's only getting a portion of us. And if I'm honest with all of you guys, if I'm just being real, I have struggled in this area for a long time. For a long time. I mean, for years, I wanted to follow Jesus, but certainly not during work hours. I mean, not if it meant I had to give up like a promotion or a bonus or recognition. I mean, not if it got in the way of how I wanted to hang out with Aaron on weeknights or my kids. Or not if it got in the way of my kids' sports during the weekends. I mean, if I'm just being real with you guys and honest, there were times in my life where I wouldn't even give up a Packer game for time with God. So the question is, what aren't you willing to sacrifice? I mean, what Jesus is teaching us here is we can't hedge our bets. I mean, it should just be evident that God is the most important thing, because no other decision in your life affects your eternity. And truly, what's more important than that? Your eternity. So the Apostle Paul describes this in Philippians 3, verses 7 and 8. But whatever gains to me, I now consider lost for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them garbage, that I may gain Christ. Guys, that Apostle Paul is a bad man, okay? And I know that's never been said on this stage. That Apostle Paul is a bad man, because those right there are some powerful words. Those are powerful words. But are they true for us? I mean, how easy is it as us for just to read God's words? We hear God's words. We agree with God's words with no intention of actual heart change, a reflection of that heart change. And again, as I've shared over the last few years when I've had the privilege to be on this stage, this right here is my story. For years, I mean, I would check boxes, I would talk a good talk when it came to my relationship with God, but it just wasn't reflected in my actions and behaviors. So you know how this works, right? God had to show me. He had to show me that my identity and security needed to be tied into him and not my career. Because you know what? Careers, trust me, they fade. Not him. Not my Heavenly Father. I mean, like jobs, they come and go. Not your Heavenly Father. Not him. I mean, all that stuff, the possessions, the things in your homes, stuff parked in your driveways, they're not everlasting. But not our Heavenly Father. He's everlasting. I mean, how many of you find yourselves building your lives around your career or your kids' sports or a hobby or a TV show or a home? I mean, I could keep going on and on. But it comes down to, what is the kingdom of God worth to you? So I'll close with a cool story. Some of you may have heard it. In 1986, there was a rock collector from Texas whose two sons had given him $5 to buy a rock for them at a rock collector show. That's a true story. These things actually exist, apparently. So when he got there, this guy, he bypasses the fancy like section up front with all the nice polished stones, and instead this guy goes to the back of the rock collector show with the amateurs, like selling rocks, and they're like in shoe boxes and Tupperware containers. And he burrows through all of them, and at one point in time, he spots a potato-sized rock from the Emerald Creek area of Idaho. So he then immediately asks the seller, "You want $15 for this rock?" And the seller replies, "Tell you what, I'll let you have it for $10. It's not as pretty as the others." The rock collector says he had no qualms paying just $10 for the potato-sized rock. And he said, when a man places a price on something he sells, that's what it's worth to him. Well, some of you might see where this is going, right? What appeared to be this dusty rock fished out of a Tupperware container in the back of a rock collector's show in Tucson, Arizona. With his trained eye, he knew it had value, and it turned out to be one of the world's largest known star sapphires, over 1,500 carats, valued at $2.5 million. Wowza. By the way, if you've learned anything today, you've learned you can make millions on storage units and rocks, okay? That you can take home. Obviously, I'm kidding. But, you know, I mean, the point of the story is a lot of us, we spend a lot of time looking for something else. I mean, possessions and stuff and relationships and experiences and careers and finances, and our kids' achievements. And we place a value in all those things. And you know what? Those things can all be amazing things, awesome things, beautiful things. They just can't be the most valuable thing. Because if so, our value proposition is skewed. It is off balance. Because we need to aim higher. I mean, our actions, behaviors need to be for a higher purpose. Because his kingdom, it supersedes all else. So when we started today, you know, we want to use scripture, the words of Jesus through the Apostle Matthew, to help you determine if the kingdom of God is worth it to you. And the questions we ask were, what do you truly value? Where do you ultimately place your confidence? And what are you willing to sacrifice for a much greater reward? So, okay, now what? Now what? Well, some of you in your room are hearing this message, and there's something inside you that tells you, when you ask yourselves those questions realistically, that something's just not quite right. Whether you're just now beginning to assess the value of your relationship between you and Christ, or you've done that assessment in the past, but for some reason right now, you're just not there. You're kind of sideways. And that's okay. But I would ask you, I would invite you, you have my permission, pull your phone out. And if you're in that place, do me a favor. Text VALUE to 920-717-1715. Text VALUE to 920-717-1715. Because we want to talk with you about that. We want to explore that with you. We want to be a part of your journey. Because these parables, these two parables, they teach us to assess the purpose of our lives and what the kingdom of God truly means to us, because it's worth it. Please bow your heads as we close in prayer. Heavenly Father, again, what a privilege it is to be in your house of worship and exploring the truth in your words. And we thank you so much for your disciple, Matthew, and the knowledge and the wisdom you passed on to him. And what I would ask, Heavenly Father, is that right now, you would just let that Holy Spirit work. Let folks who've got something stirring in their heart, that they would do something about it as they assess what do they truly value, where do they place their confidence, and what are they willing to sacrifice. Give them courage so they do something about it, Heavenly Father. Because we know when it comes to your kingdom and the kingdom of heaven, we know that it is absolutely worth it. In your good and glorious name we pray, good Lord. Amen.